And then I mentioned one new branch of this, a new branch of virtue ethics, which is quite recent. Does anyone know?
Feminism.
Feminism, yes. And what was their, what is their virtue, which they came with? So this is a new proposal, which had a very, so all this virtue ethics were all males. So the virtues were also male virtues, like courage, perseverance, brave. And then feminism, they said also, well, that's a good theory, but what do you know what? Virtue.
What?
Care, yes. It's called the ethics of care. But then again, and I go very fast, the problem is, take care for whom? Is this, for whom should we take care? And of course, and in order to answer the question, for whom, you need a different theory than this ethics of care. So maybe you can use virtue ethics as, but that's my personal opinion, as secondary ethics. So first you need to know what is good and bad, and then you can have the good virtues which go with, which are coherent with that. But you can't use it primarily because you might have the wrong virtues. So that's it. Let's do one more before the break. And that's the one which I also asked a question about on the exam. And Kant, also called deontology. From the Greek, deon means plight, your duty. Act always as if it is your duty. So Kant was very much against consequentialism. So he said you should always act according what your duty is. And how do I know what my duty is? Well, just look at use your reason. And then he said, you can, if you use your reason, you can make laws. So can I, or if I do something, then he Kant said, you always have to ask, can I make it into a general law? Can I, you shouldn't make exceptions for yourself. So should I lie? And Kant said, well, can I make an exception for myself? Can everyone do what I do? Well, it's going to be complete chaos if everyone lies. So we shouldn't do that. So Kant says, don't lie. But he doesn't want to give any exceptions. You should always abide to this moral law. And another way to put it is that you should always, so you should universalize your actions. Can I do what I do? Can everyone do that? Well, that's a nice question. To look forward to the rest of the last part of this course about environmental ethics. If you are Kantian, you can ask, can everyone live like the way I live? Well, if all 6-7 billion people would live the way we live, it's just impossible. So using Kant in this way, you can have an environmental ethics using Kant's principle. So that's, of course, Kant himself didn't think about this, but it's just an application of his way of thinking. Can everyone do what I do? Well, the answer is no. Just physically impossible. We will continue with the next one. It's a theory about rights. This is the idea that some people or some persons have rights, some fundamental inherent rights, and that these rights are, you can't violate these rights. And of course the most important thing is, of course, any questions? The Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948. This gives rights to all human beings on the planet, but we were all human beings which are living now. So, and of course it's only because the question is, of course, there are three problems. Who gets these rights? which rights and how to make sure that these rights are not violations. Because we have this beautiful Universal Declaration of Human Rights, but of course there are a lot of violations, and there is no global police force. Of course we have the United Nations, but it doesn't have any power. We have NGOs like Amnesty International that's trying to do that, but they can't really enforce these things. Which rights? Well, there's also discussion about which rights. There's no discussion also if there should be a right included, the right to a green future. So there's discussion about it. And of course, who gets rights? There's also discussion about should we include animals or some animals. There is this project called GAP, the Great Ape Project. This idea is that we should also extend some rights, not the same right, but some rights to the great apes. The great apes, orangutans, bonobos, chimpanzees, and gorillas. But that's the whole idea of the rights idea. Oh, and the sixth one is a very easy one. Maybe that's more or less the default option. It's egoism. Egoism is very easy. It's like me, me, me. So if you ask, why should I do this? Well, is it good for me? And if it is, then it is morally good, and if it's not, then it's morally not good. I mean, all dictators have this moral theory. This is the dictator's moral theory. Also the children's moral theory, so children and dictators are more or less the same moral theory. Egoism. Of course, people say, well, you know, that many egoists have a small circle of family or friends who they include in their me. You know, so you should be nice for me and my family, maybe my people around me, but they have it very small. But then there was a different version of it, the enlightened egoism. Enlightened egoism. Does anyone know who came up with that idea? Yes, Bertrand Russell. Yes, I hear that. He said, well, you know, people are at least partially self-interested, egoistic, but that you shouldn't suppress that. That's what in the whole idea of communism is that we should have a new humankind which isn't egoistic. So they had the whole education system was all about getting rid of egoism, but it doesn't work. People are a little bit self-interested. So what you can do, and that was what Russell said, well, make the best of this egoism and make sure that that you use it for the best. Like, you can use this egoism as incentive for free market, so everyone gets better, but also that you don't harm, if you make this with the liberalism, the egoism. So if you don't, you can do anything you want as long as you don't harm others. You can be as egoistic as you are. So this is like taming our egoism, taking this seriously, not denying it, but taking it seriously, and then, well, you make the best of it. Over here, also, it's important to know something about our evolutionary path, the evolution of behavior. And I told you about Frans de Waal, the primatologist who studied the behavior of gorillas. And then it shows that the natural behavior, and here we are again, here is the naturalistic fallacy. Our natural behavior is to have a very small moral circle. We are natural egoists for our group only, for ourselves, our children, maybe our group. That is our default motion. That is what is natural. So you could say, well, then it's unnatural to care, to give aid to the third world, or to be nice for people who we don't know. Yeah, in a way, that's true. It's very unnatural to be nice for people who we don't know. But then the thing is, remember the naturalistic fallacy, we shouldn't say, well, because we are that way, became that way by evolution, that we should do it. No. Ethics give you different reasons. And there is the same, like science is very difficult, it's unnatural, so ethics is also in a way unnatural. So we should expand our moral capacities, our empathic circle, but it takes effort. Naturally, we only think people like us, we like people who look like us, who behave like us, whom we know, they are friends, and all who look different or are far away are foes. But that's our moral circle. So, but we can acknowledge that and still try to improve that by enlightened egoism. So do not get away with it totally, but have an enlightened version. So the last one of it is the six. So which one we can? Oh yeah, thank you. The last one theory is the social construct theory. Which is just the idea that, well, you know, we are here together, we have to live with each other, we can kill each other, or we can make the best of it. Well, let's make the best of it. How should we do that? Well, let's start talking about, negotiate about what rules we are going to live by. Let's make the best of it with each other. So make a contract by negotiation. We sit around with each other around the table and negotiate. Then the question is, who is going to do the negotiations? Who is going to set up the rules? And here we have this whole idea of this moral agents. So these are the ones who sit around the table, and moral patients. Well, that's anyone who is not allowed to sit around the table to negotiate, but to whom the rules also apply. So usually this was the people around the table were just the males with power. And then I said, also now in our society we can all vote. People who are of age, men and women. So actually all humans, almost all humans of age are moral agents. Moral patients in our society are, well, the babies, retarded people, animals, future generations, people in third world countries who have to, well, they have consequences from what we decide. But this is social contract theory.